Hi everyone, welcome to 10 Minute Neuroscience. In this installment, I'll be covering the pathway of visual information through the brain, starting with the eye and ending with the visual cortex and surrounding areas. This will be a very general overview, and I'll be focusing more on the pathway of visual information than on the processing of that information. But this should serve as a good introduction to the way visual information travels from the eye through the brain. Of course, vision begins with the eye, but the neural aspect of vision really starts with the retina, which is the neural structure of the eye and is outlined in blue here. Other components of the eye, however, help to create a focused image on the retina. This is accomplished to a large degree through the actions of the cornea and the lens. The cornea is a transparent layer at the front of the eye that lets light into the eye. It also bends or refracts those light rays to direct the light onto the retina. The lens also helps to direct light on the retina. It has less refractive power than the cornea, but it has an advantage in that its shape can be modified by muscles in the eye called ciliary muscles. And changing the shape of the lens can help to maintain focus for objects that are closer or farther away. As people get older, their lenses become less flexible and less capable of changing shape to focus on nearby objects. This is why people tend to need reading glasses when they get older. The size of the pupil, the opening in the middle of the iris, which is the colored part of your eye, can be adjusted to regulate the amount of light that reaches the retina. For example, there are muscles in the iris that cause the pupil to dilate or open up more in low light situations and constrict in an environment with higher levels of illumination, since it doesn't need to let in as much light in that type of environment. The retina is a neural structure. It's actually considered part of the central nervous system. Its main function is to detect light and use that light to produce electrical and chemical signals that the rest of the nervous system can understand. You can see here a close-up of a section of the retina. And although there are over 1,000 different types of neurons in the nervous system, there's only 5 basic types of neurons in the retina, and those neurons are situated in distinct layers. So even though there are hundreds of millions of neurons in the retina, compared to the rest of the nervous system, it's relatively simple anatomically, and this has helped us to develop a better understanding of vision than of any other sensory system. Surprisingly, the layer of the retina that's at the very back of the eye is the layer that contains photoreceptors, the cells responsible for converting light energy into electrochemical signals, a process known as phototransduction. The location of the photoreceptors is surprising because it seems counterintuitive to have the light detecting cells at the very back of the retina. So light has to travel through the eye and then through several layers of cells to reach the photoreceptors. But it's thought that their location is strategic in the sense that they're next to a layer of the retina called the pigment epithelium. And the cells of the pigment epithelium help to maintain photoreceptor cells and keep them functioning properly. There are 2 main types of photoreceptor cells, rods and cones, which are named for their shape, as you can see here. These photoreceptor cells are the site where vision really begins. They each contain hundreds of discs that are capable of absorbing photons of light. And absorbing photons causes the photoreceptors to change levels of neurotransmitter release in order to convey information about a visual scene. Rods and cones have different functional specializations. They're involved in distinct aspects of vision. First off, cones enable us to see color, while rods don't provide for color perception. Rods are also very sensitive to light and have low spatial resolution, meaning they're not good at seeing details. Cones, on the other hand, are not very sensitive to light and have high spatial resolution, so they provide us with higher visual acuity. In low light conditions, only rods are activated. This makes it more difficult for us to make out details when there's very little light, due to the poor spatial resolution of rods, and it also means that in dim light we can't perceive color. When levels of illumination increase, eventually rods stop responding and fail to convey information. Essentially, their high sensitivity to light causes them to become overstimulated, or saturated as it's often called, in normal lighting situations like sunlight or even typical indoor lighting. So in those conditions, cones are the dominant photoreceptor in determining how we see. Surprisingly, even though cones mediate perception in typical light situations, we have far more rods than cones in the retina. There's somewhere around 90 million rods and only about 4.5 million cones. However, there is one part of the retina, an area called the fovea, where there are many more cones than rods. In fact, at the very center of the fovea, which is called the fovea, there are no rods at all. Because of its high cone content, the fovea is the part of our retina that has the capacity for our highest acuity vision. This causes us to unconsciously move our eyes so that important visual information lands on our fovea, since this is the part of our eye most capable of discerning important details. When photoreceptors absorb photons, it causes changes in the amount of neurotransmitters these cells release, and this affects the activity of the next layer of cells, bipolar cells. Bipolar cells pass on signals about perceived light to the next layer of cells, which are called ganglion cells, And these cells will carry the visual information to the brain. We'll talk more about that in a moment, but I want to mention the other two major cell types in the retina, horizontal cells and amacrine cells. Horizontal cells have dendrites that spread horizontally and make contact with multiple photoreceptor cells. Horizontal cells modulate the function of photoreceptor cells to do things like enhance contrast and adapt to changes in lighting conditions, among other things. Amacrine cells make contact with bipolar cells, ganglion cells, and other amacrine cells, and they also have a number of functions, but like horizontal cells, they're generally thought to be involved with refining the visual signal through their ability to modify the functions of other retinal cells. So horizontal and amacrine cells are involved with very early processing of visual information, but most of the visual processing occurs in the brain, so the information from the retina has to be carried out of the eye into the brain. This is accomplished by the ganglion cells, whose axons leave the eye in a bundle at a region called the optic disc. Because the optic disc is the area where the ganglion cells leave the eye, and essentially they need a place where they can exit the eye, there are no photoreceptors there. So this creates a small region where we don't receive any visual information, or a blind spot. Amazingly, we don't notice this blind spot in our visual scene because the brain fills it in with information from other photoreceptors. If you find it hard to believe that you've got a blind spot always present in your field of vision, click on this link above for a quick and simple experiment that proves the existence of your blind spot. The ganglion cells leaving the eye form the optic nerve, which is one of our cranial nerves. The optic nerve extends back to this region just below the hypothalamus called the optic chiasm. At the optic chiasm, about 60% of the axons from the optic nerve cross over to the other side of the brain, while the rest stay on the side they originated on. The fibers that are coming from the nasal part of the retina, the part closer to the nose, cross over to the other side, or decussate, while the fibers from the temporal part of the retina, the part closer to the temple, do not cross over. The result of this is that all the information from the right visual field ends up traveling to the left side of the brain, and vice versa. After the optic chiasm, the visual fibers are no longer called the optic nerve. They're now called the optic tract. The optic tracts extend to multiple areas. For example, some of the fibers go to an area in the brainstem called the pretectum, which is involved in a number of visual functions, such as the pupillary light reflex, which causes your pupils to constrict when there's greater illumination in your environment. Other fibers go to a region of the hypothalamus called the suprachiasmatic nucleus. This nucleus helps to maintain circadian or daily rhythms and uses information about light in the environment to help to do that. And still other fibers go to the superior colliculus, a region in the brainstem that, among other things, helps to coordinate head and eye movements to focus on objects of interest in the visual field. Most of the fibers in the optic tracts, however, end in a nucleus in the thalamus called the lateral geniculate nucleus. There's one on each side of the brain here. Here, the optic tracts synapse on neurons that leave the lateral geniculate nucleus and extend toward the back of the brain as bundles of fibers called the optic radiations. The optic radiations travel back to a region of cortex that surrounds a fissure called the calcarine sulcus. This small area of cortex that surrounds this calcarine sulcus is called the primary visual cortex, or V1. It's represented by this striped area here. There's a collection of myelinated fibers that forms a white stripe here that can be seen with the naked eye in anatomical brain sections of this region. And because of this striation or stripe, sometimes the primary visual cortex is called the striate cortex. The primary visual cortex helps to make a visual image out of the information that has been received by the retina. To do that, there are neurons in the primary visual cortex that are activated preferentially by different characteristics of a visual stimulus, such as orientation, movement, contrast, depth, etc. The primary visual cortex also communicates with a multitude of other visual areas that surround it, including visual area 2 or V2, visual area 3 or V3, V4, V5, and V6. Neurons in these other areas seem to be specialized to some degree for detecting specific aspects of a visual scene. Neurons in V5, for example, seem to be specialized for detecting movement. These additional visual areas are recruited by V1, and they also begin to recruit other areas of the brain to accomplish higher level processing of visual information. This enables our brain to move from identifying the basic aspects of a visual scene, such as shape and contrast, to more complex tasks like object recognition, which can provide the image in our brain with meaning based on previous experience. So we've just scratched the surface there, but I hope that gave you a sense of the major pathway that visual information travels in the brain. Thanks for watching.